Stranden ligger i Hallandale, en liten stad vid guldkusten någon mil norr om Miami i Florida. Vitskinnade, en smula blåögda kanske och väldigt svenska, landsteg vi på denna kust våren 1972 för att försöka förstå och i bilder och ljud berätta om USA som det är. Det finns emellertid åtminstone lika många uppfattningar om USA som det finns amerikaner, det vill säga omkring 210 miljoner. En av dem är Al, 50 år. Idag driver han en liten matservering i ett motell vid stranden.
How is business down here in your cup shop?
It's pretty fair for this type of operation. I mean, you can't get rich, but you work 7 days a week and you make a living.
What would you say are the conditions of life today for an ordinary working man in America?
Well, I say for an ordinary man in America, he's better off than any part of Europe or any part of the world. He has more freedom, he has more protection, got freedom of speech. Yeah, at least if you don't like your president, you can tell him where to go without being afraid of being put against the wall and shot or being punished. You have freedom of speech.
Would you say that this is a land of equal opportunities for all?
It is. If a man has a little ambition, if he's not lazy, he can always make a living.
Inte långt från motellet till polisstationen mitt i stan. Lika långt ungefär som därifrån till ett annat USA. Ett annat och hetare Hallandale som folket nere på stranden känner mycket lite till. Där finns emellertid över 20% av stans invånare. Bland andra John och Roger, 22 år båda, och båda lika mycket amerikaner som folket på stranden.
What was it like coming back to America after having fighting over in Vietnam?
Almost the same way as before I left. And when I say this, because you know, when a man goes to fight for his country and then come back over here and have to almost fight for his life, you know, in certain parts of the country, get ridiculed and, you know, and discriminated, you know, and be less than a man, I don't think it's right, you know.
Life hasn't, you know, seemed like it hasn't been has ups and downs with me. It hasn't been like I was planning for it to be, you know?
No.
Some way, you know, I got on the wrong track and fell into that gutter, and like I've been trying to get out of there for the longest, and I think the environment have a whole lot to do with keeping a man down, you know?
Yes.
And I've been trying to get out of that gutter for the last 4 years, but it looked like it's something always holding me down.
I mean, America is a possibility for everything. America is a young, dumb country, and it needs all kinds of help. America is a dumb puppy with big teeth that bite and hurt. And we take care of America. We hold America to our bosom. We feed America. We make love to America. There wouldn't be an America if it wasn't for black people. And so you have some dedicated black Americans who will die a million deaths to save America. And this is home for us. We don't know really about Africa. We talk about it in a romantic sense, but America's it. And so America's always going to be okay as long as black people don't totally lose their mind, because we'll pick up the pieces and we'll turn it into a new dance.
Now, let us begin with the modern period of, I guess we could start with 1956 for our generation. This was the beginning of the rise of Dr. Martin Luther King. Dr. King decided that in Montgomery, Alabama, black people had to pay the same prices on the buses as did white people, but we had to sit in the back. And we could only sit in the back if every available seat was taken by a white person. If a white person was standing, a black person could not sit. So Dr. King and his associates got together and said, this is inhuman. We will boycott your bus system. Now understand what a boycott is. A boycott is a passive act. It is the most passive political act that anyone can commit, a boycott. Because what the boycott was doing was simply saying, we will not ride your buses. No sort of antagonism. He was not even verbally violent. He was peaceful. Dr. King's policy was that nonviolence would achieve the gains for black people in the United States. His major assumption was that if you are nonviolent, if you suffer, your opponent will see your suffering and will be moved to change his heart. That's very good. He only made one fallacious assumption. In order for nonviolence to work, your opponent must have a conscience. The United States has none. Has none.
Okay. The first thing that crossed my mind with Stokely is, you know, he has so much power and passion and fire inside of him. And he understood what his job was very early. And he understood why, even though the things he was saying were in direct opposition to the philosophy of Dr. King, he understood that Dr. King was still important. He understood the compassion. What struck me, though, is interesting that from his vantage point, nonviolence and passive resistance was a non-option. It wasn't an option at all. Now in 2010, you can see how, you know, King and all of them who were influenced by Gandhi, how it did work, you know? The passive resistance of the bus boycott, it did work. But it would have never worked without people like Stokely Carmichael on the other side of it. They studied the passive resistance. He studied power and what power meant. He was the first one to really talk about black power. But I mean, that's exactly what was missing from the equation, the power. And he was powerful just from the speaking. And he wasn't even like the Panthers. You know, the Panthers were very influenced by him. But he, it's not like he was in the street with some guns, you know?
A few words about Martin Luther King's nonviolence movement.
I think Dr. King is a great man, full of compassion. He is full of mercy, and he's very patient. He is a man who could accept the uncivilized behavior of white Americans, their unceasing taunts, and still have in his heart forgiveness. Unfortunately, I am from a younger generation. I am not as patient as Dr. King, nor am I as merciful as Dr. King. And their unwillingness to deal with someone like Dr. King just means they have to deal with this young generation.
Thank you so much.
Let's see, I think Stokely was a sophomore in college when he went down to Mississippi. I sat by the phone, by the radio all day, trying to hear what happened. And when I heard they picked up four of them, I knew one was Stokely. I think I died 1,000 times. It was the first time he had been to jail. Every time he goes, I die 1,000 times.
Really?
Yeah.
You want me to do an interview for you?
Yeah, would you really? Oh, lovely.
Hey.
We've got one thing, though.
You
got to hold this one there, right?
Mrs. Carmichael. When you came to the United States with your children, where did you live?
We lived at Stebbins Avenue for a while.
What kind of neighborhood was it?
It was kind of a mixed neighborhood, but a little on the rundown side.
What do you mean by the rundown side?
Streets were dirty, garbage pails all thrown around and not covered and things like that.
How big was the place? place you lived in?
We had a three-room apartment there.
And how many people lived there?
When my kids moved to the United States, we were still living there, my husband and I, so that made 5 children, because I had 2 there, the 5 that came with their aunt, my husband and I.
How many is that altogether?
5 and 3, 8.
How in life in general for your children? Could they do other things most children in the United States could do? I mean, did they have enough money to do those things?
No, we didn't.
Why didn't they?
Because my husband didn't make enough money.
Why didn't he make enough money?
He was a carpenter and he worked 2 weeks in, 4 weeks off. He drove taxi cab part of the time.
But there were other carpenters who lived better than your husband.
Of course.
Why didn't your husband?
Because he was laid off. He was always the first to be laid off.
Why was he always the first to be laid off?
Because he was Negro. He always said because he was a colored man, because naturally in Trinidad we use the word colored. We never use the word Negro. So he always said because he was a colored man.
Thank you.
Are you going to return to the United States?
I most certainly am. There are 50 million black people living in the United States. And those Africans have to be organized to fight for their liberation.
Isn't there a possibility that you might end up in jail on your arrival?
I was born in jail.
No way to turn, burn, baby, burn. Called President Johnson on the telephone. Humphrey said he wasn't at home. Trying to get hold of Dr. Martin Luther King. Abernathy said he wasn't there.
Yeah.
Couldn't get no oil from the Rockefeller wells. I couldn't get no diamonds from his mine.
Yeah, yeah.
If I can enjoy the American dream, it won't be water but the fire next time. So I said, burn, baby, burn.
Burn, baby, burn.
This is for the FBI.
We went down to the pit street.
Yeah. That's a hot lot.
That's just like man, isn't it? Nothing is wasted. Everything just takes a different form. What form will you take when you die?
Shit.
The next thing is when he was burning the flame, he said, this is for the FBI. And he was maybe a fiery speaker and had passionate ideas, but he was a calm, cool, collected person. And so he's singing about this is for the FBI, but it's just words. It's just song and words. A few years ago, I was listening to Stokely Carmichael speeches while I was preparing for a new record I was working on. And it was shortly after 9/11 in America. I was making a reservation on JetBlue Airlines to fly to California. When I got to the airport, the FBI, the CIA, the TSA, they came and intercepted me, all these guys in black suits. And they took me in a back room and started questioning me about this Stokely Carmichael speech that I was listening to. They probably, you know, had some sort of bug or some sort of tap or something. But they were very concerned with me listening to this Stokely Carmichael speech from 1967, you know, 40 years ago. So words that he said, 49, we have gangster rappers. We have rappers who talk about shooting other people all the time, killing. But the FBI's not looking for them. They're looking at me because I'm listening to this speech from 40 years ago. And it shows you the power of those words is that they resonate even to now. The FBI is still scared of this man. He's, you know, he doesn't have nearly the same influence over our community as he did then. But yet, they still stopped me at the airport for listening to his speech. And then the other thing I noticed was, when you see images of Stokely, you only see the speeches. This is the first time I've seen something where he's with, just hanging out with white people, hanging out with his mother. And he just seemed like a regular dude. And that's what you don't realize about these people is that none of these people are evil or bad or even extra violent. It's just to them, common sense meant that they had to speak and stand up for themselves. So all you see is this image of them standing up for themselves. So it makes you think that they're like that all the time. But he just was a regular dude. And that's what I got from that footage with his mom.
You're really naive if you truly think that Martin Luther King just happened to be at the wrong place at the wrong time at the Lorraine Motel and this random guy just came and shot and killed him. Mm-mm. Martin Luther King sort of had a change of heart. Martin Luther King was starting to take a more militant, stronger position. And his new battle was no war. Government's like, whoa, wait, he's about to come in our territory. Like, it's one thing to let you take a shit in the same toilet that I do. You know, I'll give you that, but you ain't about to stop my money flow. You gotta go.
Well, it's very important to point out that Dr. Martin Luther King was the first prominent public figure to speak out against the war in Vietnam, especially after Dr. King made his powerful speech at the Riverside Church, in which he talked about the connection between militarism and racism. There was no way to imagine justice and equality as long as, you know, racism was being used as a weapon to attack the people of Vietnam.
The night that Dr. King was on, we spoke about death. I asked him the question, did he fear for his life? And he said, not really. He'd overcome his fear of death, and now he was focused on not how long he would live, but what would be the quality of the time that he would live. When he said, this is no longer about race, it's now about the welfare and the well-being of human life. We must talk about economics. We must talk about where people are poor. We must galvanize our nation to begin to take care of the poor. America should not have no poor people. No one should ever go to bed hungry. There should be gainful employment. There should be a living wage. There should be access to health with no charge. We should have education for free, like so many other nations successfully have applied. All these things put a huge bullseye on Dr. King because he was now tampering with the playground of the wealthy. And when he came to that moment about dismantling the economic construct, he had to go.
We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man.
In 1968, Martin Luther King was killed, Robert Kennedy was killed, Medgar Evers was killed, Mark Clark and Fred Hampton were killed, John Carlos and Tommy Smith did the Black Power salute in Mexico City. I mean, it is a litany of things that took place in 68. Like, that was the moving the stone from in front of the cave in 68. I mean, it really was a special beginning and opening. And unfortunately, anytime you have anything that's an opening, death accompanies those things.
When white America killed Dr. King last night, she declared war on us.
There were many sacrifices. When they say we stand on the shoulders of people, we are actually in the palm of the hands of a lot of folks because we were moved and motivated and charged up by people who had already made a commitment in the 60s to bring about change. And even though I was really on the periphery, I was on the outside looking in, I didn't know much. I knew I wanted to be a part of the Black Power movement, but I didn't know how to be a part of it. But I felt it was something necessary. No, what he did, I still could not have marched with Dr. King. I could never have been with him on any level. I did not agree with his philosophy, and I still don't agree with his philosophy.
They called in the combined police forces of Berkeley, Oakland, and San Francisco, the California Highway Patrol, and 3,000 National Guardsmen. and they just went crazy. They began shooting at everything they moved. They shot about 300 people, but they only killed one person.
I do agree with fighting fire with fire. I'm not going to fight fire with water necessarily. I mean, if someone charges at me, I'm going to defend myself. Dr. King was not about that, but what he did do, the exposing the demons that existed in America, that's priceless. You can't. I mean, it was a sacrifice, but he showed you this is America. Look at this. I mean, we're nonviolent. We're singing We Shall Overcome. And they got the dogs on us. They're putting us in prison. They're beating the hell out of us. And, of course, when he was killed, I was shattered just by the fact that this man wasn't fighting with the guns and weapons that they're fighting with. So I personally felt an insult to that. But I could have never marched Malcolm's concepts and theories about how we should deal with ourselves, how we should really function in this society. That's what made sense to me. So when you look at the last poets, you're really looking at disciples of Malcolm X.
That as long as a white man does it, it's all right. A black man is supposed to have no feelings. But when a black man strikes back, he's an extremist. He's supposed to sit passively and have no feelings, be nonviolent, and love his enemy, no matter what kind of attack, be it verbal or otherwise, he's supposed to take it. But if he stands up and in any way tries to defend himself, then he's an extremist.
The nurse that is now in Harlem is, kind of just starting, and I think it's going to brew and grow much larger. And it isn't entirely the Harlemers' fault, because most of the people in Harlem are Negroes, and most of the people in Harlem are Negroes, and it seems as though most of the big stores or anything that really makes money is owned by a person of another race, and they're kind of kept down from achieving any kind of goal for themselves. And their three heroes of this century have been just cut down in the prime of youth, you could say. And
which heroes are you thinking of?
John Fitzgerald Kennedy, Martin Luther King Jr., and Robert Francis Kennedy.
Skottet mot Robert Kennedy har skakat USA. Det här är utanför St. Patrick's-katedralen i New York, medan Robert Kennedy ligger på Little Parade. Många fruktar att man är för sent ute med det sociala reformprogram som kunnat ge fattig- och slumamerikas 30 miljoner människor en människovärdigare tillvaro. Att man är för sent ute för att hejda den stigande oron i USAs många negergetto och undvika nya politiska mord och blodiga sammanstötningar.
What I think about the future? There ain't no future. That's all it is to it.
No future at all.
Why don't you think it's a future?
They killed Kennedy, they killed King, they killed Evers. They're killing all the people that do something. Yeah, to do something for the black man, you know, that stood up for him. Those are the only men that really stood up for him. And I don't know, it seems like it's conspiracy. I don't know, people say maybe it isn't, you know, but I think it really is. It has to be something, you know.
I don't think there is much of a future at this point.
You mean from black people?
Not much at all. They're just killing everybody that
for their own nation.
For the nation itself. For the nation itself.
Klockan är 7 på morgonen och en ny dag börjar i de mörka, nedslitna rummen på Hopkinson Avenue. Maggie Miley klär sina 10 barn. 2 är snuviga, 1 hittar inte sina skor, alla är sömniga, alla är hungriga. Det är en dag som alla andra. De stora barnen som går till skolan får ingenting att äta på morgonen. De små får vad som finns i huset. Denna morgon fanns bara lite cornflakes.
There's no milk to put in it now. Yeah, come on, baby. Eat some of that then. Eat it, it tastes like cookies, taste it.
Can I sing it? I want a world where kids can play and plenty of food to eat. I want a world where I can speak and know that I'll be free. I want a world just like America, like the USA. 'Cause even though perfect it's not, it's the best thing this world's got. You know, and we learn those types of songs. So we learn not to question our government and be grateful for everything we got. But we didn't know that it was at the expense of many other people in our own country and all over the world. Because you're taught to fear that you don't have enough and want and want and want. So it perpetuates greed. We are kept uneducated, sick, and depressed. There's a happy ending, but with not happy mistakes first. And one of the biggest mistakes is the greed.
The birth of this nation was conceived in the genocide of the red man. Genocide of the red man. Of the red man.
I was in San Francisco helping to begin Black Studies when Stokely came with his cadre to merge with the Black Panther. And I remember the gorgeous signs that they made. I remember the meeting. And what we began to see at that point was the fusion of the Southern movement with the Northern movement to form quite a group of young people who were looking at the world in a way that did not necessarily say nonviolence, but it didn't say violence. It merely said at some point, let's take the movement a step further.
I believe that a time has come, a point has been reached, where a line just has to be drawn. There's a favorite line that I know about, and it says that there is a point where caution ends and cowardice begins. All three of these pigs that we have a choice of, Oink Nixon, Oink Humphrey, and Oink Wallace, they're not for us. They do not represent the best interests of this country. They definitely don't represent the best thinking in this country. In fact, they represent the very worst tradition that was ever to crawl from beneath the rocks in this bankrupt country.
It's right to defend yourself against anything and anyone. No, we don't believe in violence. We don't believe in killing. We don't believe in harming or hurting. We weren't the ones who inflicted pain and harm on people. We weren't the ones who kidnapped a whole culture of people and brought them to do service for us. And because we stand and fight back and want peace, we want to work with pride. Love and live and grow with pride. That's all we want. And to say that we're wrong to defend ourselves is idiotic. Seriously, twisted. Shame on America for that. Shame on any person who judges someone for defending himself or his family. Shame.
Oh, yeah.
Det här är Svarta Pantrarnas centrala högkvarter. Härifrån styrs partiets 44 avdelningar i USA och ambassad i Algeriet. Och härifrån leder man en hel rad sociala aktiviteter bland de fattiga i USAs ghetto. Svarta Pantrarna har existerat i drygt 4 år och är USAs mest militanta svarta organisation.
Det här är kontoret i Harlem. Här arbetar de 21 svarta pantrar som nu sitter i fängelse i New York och avvaktar rättegång. Här inne sker dock politisk utbildning idag i alla fall. Regelrätta klasser och revolutionskunskap. Det är nästan bara kvinnor som är lärare. Männen sitter i fängelse. Det är så man arbetar på revolutionen i Amerika. Man läser pantertidningen och diskuterar.
No, we're making the revolution by educating the people to the fact that they should arm themselves with self-defense. You see, educate them to what the power structure is doing to them, that they made racism the primary objective that the people have to deal with when we mainly have to deal with capitalism. You see, the more we intensify the struggle, you're going to see more and more where they're going to start killing us, because they got too many of us in jail now, and they don't want no more of us in jail, so they got to kill us. So it's not fun having all these people in jail, but these are freedom fighters. They're the vanguard. And they're here to liberate the people, and this, and they know this. They either have to go to jail or die. And if you're not prepared for that, then you don't belong in the Black Panther Party.
Black Panther Party started in Oakland, California. And so, you know, the party is known mostly for its confrontational stances. And that's a good thing, to be confrontational against evil and violence. The kind of problems that the Black community suffer, unequal levels of imprisonment, unequal levels of access to resources, poor health. And so the Black Panther Party tried to model for the community some of the possible solutions that were not capitalist-oriented, like free clinic. You know, you can come here and get free medical care, or send your children to us, we will feed them for free. And this idea of free breakfast is one of the legacies that's been adopted. Now the schools have free breakfast, but they didn't before. I think the party, that's not the only organization that did it, but it's the only organization based in ghetto communities that did it.
Svarta pantrarna är ett revolutionärt amerikanskt parti, säger Bobby Seale, som i första hand vill uppfylla den svarta befolkningens elementära behov, bland annat av arbete, mat, bostäder och undervisning, och lära dem att skydda sig mot polisövergrepp. Men man samarbetar också ideologiskt och praktiskt med grupper av vita radikala, liksom med andra revolutionära organisationer i USA.
And we look at this program as a very international type program. It's for any human beings who want to survive. So
it's a plain socialist program, you mean?
Definitely. Socialism is the order of the day, and not Nixon's black capitalism. That's out.
Black Panthers is an armed organization. What does that mean?
It means that if any racist dog, policemen, or pigs come up and attack us at any point or whatever point, we will defend ourselves, we will shoot them, we will kill them, because we are bent on surviving.
And you have arms to do this?
Oh, definitely. And we are trying to get as many arms as we can, and we are teaching the people themselves in the community to arm themselves.
I wanted some grassroots up power to the people. Legislation and laws that gave the grassroots real empowerment, you know what I mean? What I believed in was how we could get greater community control and community input into the political institutions that affect our lives. The very philosophy and slogan that we're spouting is all power to all the people. Whether you're white, black, blue, red, green, yellow, or polka dot, in the final analysis, we want real people's community control empowerment.
Förutom fria skolfrukostar och luncher har svarta pantrarna fria hälsokliniker och fri juridisk service för att hjälpa de fattiga mot polisen, hyresvärdarna och socialvårdsmyndigheterna. Man har även ett program för fria kläder och för försvar av politiska fångar. Partimedlemmarna själva får bland annat vapen och sjukvårdsutbildning.
All power to the people!
All power to the people!
Free Bobby!
Free Bobby!
Free Erica!
Free Erica!
Free Angela!
Free Angela!
Free all political prisoners!
Free all political prisoners!
Right on!
I mean, this is a period when America's empire really takes off. Besides the war in Vietnam, there are all these other kinds of interventions Between 1964 and 1972, there are 300 urban rebellions in cities, 60,000 people arrested, billions of dollars worth of property damaged, 250 people killed. Almost all these incidents were caused by some police violence, police brutality. And if you're looking from the outside in, I don't care if you're in Beijing, you're in New Delhi, or you're in Malmo, you're gonna see America with this internal war. It looks like a racist war.
Politiska rättegångar börjar bli allt vanligare i USA. Vi har nu i 19 veckor kunnat följa rättegången mot 7 radikala gruppers ledare i Chicago för att de konspirerat i avsikt att starta upplopp vid det demokratiska partiets konventer. Det är en rättegång som har handlat mindre om det påstådda brottet än om de anklagades samhällssyn och kritik av det amerikanska samhället.
Yes, it's a political trial. We told the judge that when you take militant Black Panthers who have been created by a system of oppression and you bring them into a courtroom, you're creating a political trial. Added to it, of course, is the severe punishment that they've already suffered, waiting almost 1 year for trial in jail conditions that are certainly from the Middle Ages.
For me to have lived through and seen this through my young eyes in the late 60s and 70s, but then to see it all through the eyes of a Swedish crew, it's even more fascinating because there's a sense of innocence that I think is evident, but yet it's not really an innocence as much as it is also a global perspective that's pretty extraordinary. There's simply no way to predict that this revolution will come to an end. What will be next?
Högst uppe i LBR i Alger, där de fina villorna ligger, har Eldridge Cleaver och Svarta Pantrarna sitt högkvarter. Villan har den algeriska regeringen ställt till deras förfogande. Cleaver, hans hustru och de cirka 20-talet andra pantrarna, inklusive barnsköterskorna, är omhändertagna av den algeriska regeringen. Men Cleaver är landsflyktig. Målet förefaller så avlägset och man har en känsla av att själva fjädern inom honom är bruten.
According to my observations, and depending upon how the struggle develops, the next stage is to achieve what the South Vietnamese have achieved, that is a provisional government, a government that's not in full control of its territory, that does not enjoy its full sovereignty, but which is recognized on a full diplomatic level by sympathetic governments and people around the world. Of course, we realize we are a far stage away from that, but the status that we have achieved enables us to function.
Det här är Hugh Newton, Svarta Pantrarnas grundare och ledare, på väg ut från rättegång i Oakland, Kalifornien. För fjärde gången har hans rättegång uppskjutits. Hugh Newton är nu fri mot en borgen på 250 000 kronor. Just nu pågår en hel rad politiska rättegångar i USA mot vänsterradikaler. Förutom mot Bob Beale, också till exempel mot Angela Davis, svart kommunist, och mot 13 ledande pantrar i New York. Och partiets informationsminister Eldridge Cleaver befinner sig i landsflykt i Algeriet. Huey P. Newton, den enda panterledaren på fri fot nu. Domen på 14 års fängelse för polisdråp var felaktig. Han låg själv medvetslös när dråpet begicks.
My treatment was generally abusive and oppressive, and primarily because of the fact that I was a prisoner of war and a political prisoner.
What do you think is going to happen with the Black Panthers now? You're losing your leaders, etc.
It is true that many of our leaders have been confined in the concentration camps here in America. I know that the Black Panther Party will prevail. It is the vanguard of the people's struggle, and that while leaders are put into prison, new leaders are born, new leaders are made.
Av alla länder förutom Sverige så är USA det land som uppmärksammas mest i svensk TV. Men ger svensk TV en snedvriden bild av USA? Är svensk TV anti-amerikansk? Ja, att det är så hävdades för ett tag sedan i USAs största veckotidning, TV Guide. Författaren Merrill Pannett skrev artiklarna efter ett besök i Europa. Mest kritisk var den här artikelserien mot TV-bolagen i Holland och Sverige, och allra värst var det i Sverige.
The only thing I was interested in when I was there was the Swedish television's coverage of America, American news, and that I did criticize because I felt that there was a general anti-American feeling.
How would you define the concept of anti-Americanism?
I would define it as emphasizing only negative aspects of America and none of the positive ones.
Här är några av formuleringarna i TV Guide.
Sverige har den mest ohämmat anti-amerikanska TV:n på den här sidan om järnridån.
De amerikanska B-52-planen har under fredag och lördag fällt över 1000 ton bomber.
I svensk TV skildras USA som ett ondskefullt land styrt av ondskefulla män. Nyhetsmaterial från amerikanska TV-bolag som ofta är tillräckligt negativt från början, redigeras så att det ska ge en ännu negativare bild. Bara i svensk TV tycks det finnas en verklig fiendskap mot USA.
But you see that we are seeing the bad news about America on our own television, the context of living here, of seeing about us every day the positive aspects, so that we have a more realistic perspective of what's going on in America. Whereas the people in Sweden, people abroad, are not living in America, do not see any of the positive aspects of it, and are getting just the bad news. And this is the thing that I objected to.
I think that one very important factor in this change, because I think there's a change too, is the war, of course.
There's no doubt about that.
Because that's changed.
I'm sure the war is as unpopular here as it is in Sweden, but we're stuck with it.
Yeah.
I mean, this is an American problem.
Well, TV Guide is an absolute nothing magazine. TV Guide is a special kind of magazine that panders to the lowest possible taste in American life. This is one of the reasons it has such a wide circulation. I found it very curious that TV Guide should suddenly attack Swedish and Dutch television. And meaningful, and deeply meaningful, not in the sense that anybody would believe it, and the average reader of TV Guide doesn't care about that kind of thing, but when you consider who the publisher of TV Guide is, and the publisher of TV Guide is Walter Annenberg, who's the United States ambassador to London, and who is one of Mr. Nixon's closest advisors, as well as one of his closest financial supporters. What I suppose anti-American really means, by and large, at least the way I interpret it, I'm regarded as anti-American. I am not anti-American. I'm simply against those institutions which rule America. I'm against those institutions which encourage racism, which have put us into the war and kept us into the war. The true picture of what goes on here can even be seen in American television if you look at it long enough. The emptiness, the spiritual bleakness, the loss of meaning, the loss of purpose. The TV Guide article on Swedish television is simply a reflection of Mr. Nixon's paranoia.
We'll be right back.
var klockan 8:30 på morgonen de 1200 fångar i Attica-fängelset gjorde uppror med 38 vakter tagna som gisslan. Fångarna ställde villkor i 30 punkter. Kraven dominerades av önskemål om mänskligare behandling, om slut på fysisk misshandel, om tandborstar, tvål och dusch varje dag, om chans till yrkesträning och tillgång till tidningar och böcker. I 4 dygn varade upproret. Den 13 på morgonen stormade polis och nationalgardister fängelset. 40 människor sköts ihjäl, 31 fångar och 9 vakter som hade hållits som gisslan. Det sades omedelbart att fångarna hade skurit halsarna av de 9 dödade vakterna. Men obduktionen visade senare att alla hade skjutits ihjäl av de stormande trupperna.
It's murder under any doctrine of civilized standards that any country ever had.
William Kunstler är en radikal advokat som har figurerat i många starkt uppmärksammade rättegångar. Han var också inne i Attica-fängelset under revolten och medla mellan fångarna och myndigheterna. Han säger nu att det var guvernören som är den skyldiga till mordet.
Prisoners had two non-negotiable demands, the removal of the warden and general amnesty, and they had already given up on the removal of the warden. And on the general amnesty, we had worked out several formulas that we were discussing with the commissioner hours before the attack. And if we had been allowed to continue, everyone would be alive and the matter would be settled today.
But you yourself said at one point that you feared for your life in there.
Well, I guess I'm a white middle-class citizen of this country, and I had all the stereotypes about prisoners that any person in my capacity has. I had to learn the hard way that they were decent, honorable men, much more decent and much more honorable than the people who went in there to shoot them.
I can't look at the Attica uprising without imagining myself there or without taking into account my own experience with prison. And I know that from the inside out, I never lost my humanity, my decency. No matter how many times I felt encaged and felt like I was treated as an animal over the course of my own incarceration. So I can't look at Attica and not sympathize with those prisoners and those inmates who wanted to be treated more decently for whatever reason. It's a question of dignity and decency. If we look at it from a purely historical standpoint, leading up to the civil rights movement in Attica, there was nothing that ever happened up until that point where there was such a pivotal change in what was allowed to take place, the violence that erupted and demanded the world pay attention. Because from a human rights perspective, the question it comes down to something that's very fundamental. Do prisoners have human rights?
To me, the worst crime that could ever be committed on mankind is really ignorance. You know, people that don't do anything are perceived just as guilty as those who did something. Americans, especially privileged Americans, are really in denial about what is going on for black people, for underprivileged people, period, but mainly for black people. You know, just because I'm allowed to drink out the same water fountain or, you know, have a turkey dinner at Woolworth's lunch counter doesn't necessarily equal progress, or it doesn't mean that the wrongs of 400 years has justified.
What is the new policy of the Black Panthers now?
The policy isn't new. We like to say that we're returning to what we call our original vision, which was to serve the people and to move the masses of our people, black and other oppressed people inside of this country, to the point of total liberation. What is new is that we have stopped becoming what we would call a revolutionary cultist group. We're not here to build heroic images that people can make posters out of and that they can glorify. The point is for the struggle to be waged between the oppressed people and the oppressor, not between the Black Panther Party and the police.
What do you think about Angela Davis? She's not from the Black Panthers Party.
No, Angela Davis is a very close friend of the Black Panther Party. She was a very good friend of mine, even prior to her being in the organization, the Communist Party, as she is now, and prior to my being in the Black Panther Party. And she's always been very close and a very firm fighter, a very strong fighter for the people's liberation.
Angela Davis. Hennes namn och hennes bild är bekant från hundratusentals demonstrationer över hela världen. Hon är en symbol för svart kamp och för radikala idéer och för motstånd mot förtryck från myndigheterna. Inte bara i Amerika, utan över hela världen. Det har demonstrerats till hennes förmån i Afrika. Det har demonstrerats i Latinamerika, över hela Europa. Från Ryssland har kommit protester. Det var här det började. Det här är Marin Countys domstol. Den 7 augusti 1970 stod här James McLean åtalad för ett knivslagsmål inne i San Quentin-fängelset. Han var en fånge på det fängelset. Och som vittnen uppträdde två andra svarta fångar. Det han har egentligen ingenting med Angela Davis att göra. Man vet inte ens om de kände varandra. Mer än att i rättegångssalens åhörare satt också Jonathan Jackson. 17 år gammal, yngre broder till soldatbrodern George Jackson med vilken Angela Davis hade så nära som kontakt. Jonathan Jackson reste sig upp i domstolslokalen och skrek alla står stilla, tog upp ett vapen, lämnade över flera vapen till de två svarta vittnena och till den åtalade och så tog de en gisslan. Man kom inte längre än hit ut på parkeringsplatsen. Här blev det skottlossning med polisen varvid både domaren, de två svarta vittnena och Jonathan Jackson, 17 år, dödades. Polisen sa efteråt att Angela Davis ägde och hade köpt de vapen som Jonathan Jackson använde. Själv försvann Angela Davis och man hittade henne först långt senare på ett hotell i New York. Det är åtalet mot henne. Eftersom hon ägde vapnen så är hon medskyldig till det mord som ägde rum här. Och efter enligt Kaliforniens lagar så kan man för sådan medverkan till mord också bli dömd till döden.
This trial I think will be historic in its unfairness. There's no evidence at all to involve Miss Davis in the charges. None whatsoever. And I think that they seized upon this opportunity to, you know, try and put her to death. Governor Reagan originally fired her from her teaching job at the University of California, and this is simply an extension of that, as far as I'm concerned. The evidence presented to the grand jury shows that the guns that were used in the shootout in San Rafael were registered in her name. Now, assuming for the sake of argument that that's true, that's all it shows, that she owns some guns. There's nothing illegal in the state of California about owning guns. They were registered, and it's not a crime. But because of the inflammatory press that had built up around this incident, and because of the need that the government felt to put her in jail, and to hopefully, from their point of view, to kill her, they could put enough pressure in that grand jury room to get an indictment.
Ingen tror att hon låg bakom morden. Hennes rättegång kommer att bli mer politisk än många andra. Det kommer hon själv och hennes tusentals anhängare att se till. Hon har fått den bästa utbildning som någon svart i Amerika har fått. Universitetsprofessorerna sa det var den mest begåvade elev de någonsin hade haft. Och i Tyskland mötte hon sedan Herbert Marcuse. Det var från honom hon fick intresset för filosofi och marxism väckt. Hennes doktorsavhandling handlade om Kants analys av våldet i den franska revolutionen. Hon är intelligentare och kunnigare än de flesta. Hon har inte brutits ner av fängelsevistelsen. Hon hungerstrejkar i fängelset som protest mot förhållandena där. Hon är svart, hon är kvinna, hon är åtalad för mord. Trots det framstår hon som ett ideal, inte bara för kvinnorörelsen, utan för de flesta svarta.
And in my case, when I think about the fact that Ronald Reagan was the governor of California, Richard Nixon was the president of the U.S., the whole apparatus of the state was set up against me. They had all of their resources, and the FBI, the police, and they really meant to send me to the death chamber in order to make a point. It really didn't matter who I was, or it was that I was a very convenient figure to make a point that they would suppress any efforts at revolution and liberation.
Mycket få har träffat henne. Hon sitter i denna byggnad, en domstolslokal strax utanför San Francisco, i källarvåningen i ett liten cell där. Detta är första gången en tv-kamera bärs in till henne. Själv verkar hon tyst och blek när hon kommer in.
A year ago, the Black Panthers were much more active. You heard much more about that type of struggle. Is the time of the Black Panthers past?
The Black Panthers still exist, and the Black Panthers are still extremely active in the Oakland community and in communities all over the country. I'm not sure whether you are aware of what is now happening in the Black Panther Party and the kinds of things that members of that party are doing
no,
now.
No, but tell me.
First of all, if you're going to talk about a revolutionary situation, you have to have people who are physically able to wage revolution, who are physically able to organize and physically able to do all that is done.
Yeah, but the question is more, how do you get there? Do you get there by confrontation, violence?
Oh, is that the question you were asking?
Yeah.
See, that's another thing. When you talk about a revolution, most people think violence. Without realizing that the real content of any kind of revolutionary thrust lies in the principles and the goals that you're striving for, not in the way you reach them. On the other hand, because of the way this society is organized, because of the violence that exists on the surface everywhere, you have to expect that there are going to be such explosions. You have to expect things like that as reactions. If you are a black person and live in the black community all your life and walk out on the street every day seeing white policemen surrounding you, when I was living in Los Angeles, for instance, long before the situation in L.A. ever occurred, I was constantly stopped. No, the police didn't know who I was, but I was a black woman and I had a natural, and they, I suppose, thought that I might be a, quote, militant. And when you live under a situation like that constantly, and then you ask me, you know, whether I approve of violence. I mean, that just doesn't make any sense at all. Whether I approve of guns. I grew up in Birmingham, Alabama. Some very, very good friends of mine were killed by bombs that were planted by racists. I remember from the time I was very small, I remember the sounds of bombs exploding across the street, our house shaking. I remember my father having to have guns at his disposal at all times because of the fact that at any moment we might expect to be attacked. The man who was at that time in complete control of the city government, his name was Bull Connor, would often get on the radio and make statements like, niggers have moved into a white neighborhood, we better expect some bloodshed tonight. And sure enough, there would be bloodshed. After the four young girls who lived, one of them lived next door to me. I was very good friends with the sister of another one. My sister was very good friends with all three of them. My mother taught one of them in her class. My mother, in fact, when the bombing occurred, one of the mothers of one of the young girls called my mother and said, can you take me down to the church to pick up Carol? We heard about the bombing, and I don't have my car. And they went down, and what did they find? They found limbs and heads strewn all over the place. And then after that, in my neighborhood, all of the men organized themselves into an armed patrol. They had to take their guns and patrol our community every night because they did not want that to happen again. I mean, that's why when someone asked me about violence, I just find it incredible. What it means is that the person who's asking that question has absolutely no idea what black people have gone through, what black people have experienced in this country since the time the first black person was kidnapped from the shores of Africa.
In this period, the pain to remain the same outweighed the pain to change. I see that the time period brought on an evolution, and it's contagious like hot coals. One ignites the next, and the next, and the next, and the next. When you get tired enough is when you begin to want to sacrifice everything inside of you. The fear just leaves. This is what happened in this time period.
One of the first books that I read when I went away was a book by Angela Davis called Are Prisons Obsolete? So it allowed me to examine prisons within America from their history and their role in society. Life comes full circle sometimes. My senior paper, prior to graduating, was written on Angela Davis. And I studied her. I studied at her feet without ever meeting her. Because agree with her or disagree with her, her thinking is so critical that it forces you to pay attention and to re-examine what you've taken for granted. To be reintroduced to one of my childhood heroes during one of the darkest periods of my life over the course of my own incarceration was moving, inspiring, cathartic, in some ways depressing. The book isn't, it's neither dense nor thick. It's almost pamphlet-like, which made it really accessible as an introductory text. Other inmates would see me reading and they'd come up to me and they'd say, well, John, you know, I don't have a lot of experience with reading and I don't do it often, but can you recommend a book? And on many, many occasions, I went into my property locker and I pulled out that book and I made them promise to return it in the same condition that it was given. But that book was a treasure to me and it remains a treasure. That's one of the things that I took with me when I left.
And a thunderous, resounding, united voice that we have no intentions of stopping this fight until we have eradicated every single remnant of racism in this country. Until we have ended the war in Vietnam and the neo-colonialism in Africa. We are not going to stop fighting until every political prisoner is free and until all the monstrous dungeons in this country are mere memories of a nightmare. Sisters and brothers, that is what the power of the people is all about.
And you're standing in a place where the largest collection of black books in the world. And I started off some 40 years ago in this place, sleeping in the cellar. My receipts each day was around a dollar and a quarter. But I don't tell how much my receipts is a day for Internal Revenue will be looking for me.
Everything about who I am comes from growing up in Brooklyn and comes from my parents. They laid the foundation. But a big part of why I've been able to touch the world through my music and express myself has to do with the years I spent in a black bookstore. I mean, this store looks, in Harlem, identical to Nkiru Books that I worked at. The book titles, I know all those books. I read all those books. And it's interesting that that stuff was still relevant to me when I was working there in the 90s, as relevant as it was in the 70s, because the issues are still the same.
Malcolm X was the smartest uneducated. You see, Malcolm X, they could find nobody with no degree of PhD could debate him on truth. And naturally, this country can't stand truth. Now, I was lecturing the other day down in this same cellar, and a gang of little black boys came in, they held up their fists, talking about black power. I said, look, son, I'd like to straighten you out. I said, black is beautiful, but black isn't power. Knowledge is power. For you can be black as a crow, you can be white as snow, and if you don't know and ain't got no dough, you can't go, and that's for sure. The white man that landed here, he came with two great weapons. One is the Bible, and the other was the gun. If it didn't humble you with the Bible, it crumble you with the gun. And he's still praising the Lord and passing ammunition all over the world.
You know, the points he said about black power, I think, is very, very, very important. But you have to grow and change. You can't just be caught up in the racial aspect of it. You have to, he said in the little poem he said, you have to know and you have to have the dough. You know, you can't just be caught up in, oh, do it just because it's black. So it's interesting that he ran a black bookstore. He understood the importance of the bookstore, but he also understood it's not just about the black. You know, that's a tool. That's not the goal.
Anybody can die nobly for a cause. The sign of maturity is to live day by day for that cause. And that cause is not a racial cause. He is here. Somewhere else it's a religious cause, something, but it's really just simply freedom. Okie doke.
This whole kind of falling in love with black things for a short period of time is essentially racist. It still is hypothesized on a great sense of separateness and a sense of treating black activities as a kind of a curiosity, either benign or threatening, one or the other. When it's threatening, you know, oh my God, they're going to riot or something, and when it's benign, let's let them paint or draw or sing or dance or whatever they want to do until we get tired of it, until, you know, we the white community get tired of it. And that whole structure is essentially racist.
Del, nämligen Harlem. Det här är onekligen den färgade mannens slumkvarter. I Harlem försiggår det så oerhört mycket narkotikapreparat. Man ska alltså skaffa sig pengar för att ta en kil eller vad det nu är det heter, en spruta eller någonting. Ni har kanske studerat vårt välkomstbrev, där säger vi att vi vill inte gärna att någon går upp här i Harlem för privata studier. Det är nämligen så att den här stadsdelen är endast för färgade människor. Och inte ens de bättre, om jag kan säga så, de bättre färgade människorna går upp här, för att det är alltså riskerar att man kan bli rånad.
Well, I see this block is business as usual.
Yeah,
instead of 100 junkies out today, must be 1,000 out.
What do you say we take a ride up 127th Street and see the press?
Yeah.
Right?
Okay, yeah.
See, we got any new faces working.
That's us, Bob. Let's go.
One less.
I'm frustrated all the time by what I see and wonder when it'll end and if it ever will end. I'm frustrated by whitey's contributions. His contributions are usually drugs, which bring to me youngsters of my race, young people. This is what is so frustrating. These are pre-teenagers, 13 to 15, dead from overdose, and We see this too often.
To call this a war on drugs, it evokes a very, very violent image. So you have, by the mere name alone, you think of what comes with war. The violence, the casualties, the explosions, the pain, the grief, the suffering, the messiness of it all. If you are on the other side of the war, you are an enemy combatant, and enemy combatants can be dealt with however. And indeed, the war on drugs swept everyone up. And the numbers speak for themselves. As the black population comprises 13% of American citizens, yet 49%, almost 50% of the prison population. It begs the question, who is failing whom?
You know how many guys out here like me selling dope? You know how many kilos of dope coming to the United States? You know how many times it's handled and how many people get a cut off that money? Everyone is selling dope. From the government on down. You don't cut off the hand that feeds you. So in other words, if that's where I'm getting the dope from, should I tell and cut off my neck?
I mean, yeah, you know, the 60s was very revolutionary in terms of thought and in terms of imagery. Black is beautiful. We love ourselves. And it's documented. It's not even a myth or anything that is a conspiracy theory that the community was flooded with drugs in order to stop this stuff. I mean, you know, Hoover and the FBI, and they made sure that the drugs were an influence in the community. And it certainly had its effects. Just how drugs affect your brain, they affected the community. It made everything out of focus. Everything fuzzy. The drugs almost had a renaissance when they did the same thing with crack. You know, it was heroin then, it was crack after that. But that's, you know, people who are poor and oppressed, they focus on survival. The drugs seem like an easy escape route.
I'm 27 years old, and I can remember back 1966 when I first went to the United States Army. Now they have brothers overseas that don't even know about heroin. And they come overseas with the fact of being a good soldier, you know, doing for their country what they have no country, you know. And it goes over there and they get hooked. You know, I think they wanted it this way, you know, because so many brothers done died, it's a shame, you know. And they be lying about the fact, they be lying, they be saying your son died in combat. He didn't die in combat, he died from an overdose. And as you can see in the papers, everybody's involved. Big people's involved. They can't break it open.
We were aware of some of the collateral consequences of the war in Vietnam, including the fact that young men who fought there returned with serious drug problems. And that was the beginning of the period where massive drug problems in black communities, and the government was involved in some way. The CIA was involved with the distribution of drugs. Drugs were responsible for the receding of militancy and, you know, revolutionary impulses in black communities all over the country.
I look out on the world and I see people who have lost the awareness of being committed to any kind of cause at all. There's no unity in the world. You couldn't rally 500 people to sincerely fight for the same common cause, no matter what that cause might be, unless it's dollars. The result of this is, of course, the chaos that we live in. I fight drug addiction in Harlem. I run the Addicts Rehabilitation Center. It's a tragedy that we live in a society that believes that it can do everything, that it can go to the moon, and yet it does not believe that it can cure a drug victim of a malady that the society has caused. That's a disgrace.
The black people here in Harlem are more intellectually independent than black people anywhere in America. Black people in Harlem can think for themselves, and black people in Harlem think black. Black people in New York, they think black, they walk black, they talk black, they're proud to be black.
Well, Harlem is romanticized for the culture, And Harlem is different now that has been gentrified a few times over. So you have influences and money in Harlem that wasn't there, but you still have this. You know, rich, famous people living there, but right there on the corner, they're still selling crack, they're still selling heroin, there's still these same traps. Harlem is the complete metaphor for the Black experience in America.
I am Louis Farrakhan, minister of Muhammad's Temple, number 7 in New York City, and the national spokesman for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Nation of Islam. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that Almighty God Allah revealed to him that the white race is a race of devils. Devil meaning wicked by nature. What more could a devil do than what has been done to the black man of America? In theology, we have been taught that the devil would get you after you are dead, if you were bad, and you would go to hell, a place of eternal fire, and there the devil would torment us. Well, in that sense, that's a pretty merciful theology, because at least when you go to hell and meet the devil, you are dead. And being dead, you are not able to feel a pain. Now we are in a literal hell in America.
This is a very significant interview because 1974 is about the time when Louis Farrakhan basically made a bid for leadership of what becomes the Nation of Islam. It was a moment when the Nation of Islam itself was full of corruption, internal violence, assassinations, full of thuggery in some ways. Louis Farrakhan's stature rose significantly at this period. Even in 74, those inside the Nation of Islam and those who had continued to work within Malcolm's Organization of Afro-American Unity had never trusted Farrakhan. They were convinced that he was involved in assassination. And so what Farrakhan ends up doing is playing down that part. He stops vilifying Malcolm X. Malcolm X dead is more useful to him than alive.
We do not smoke. We do not drink. We do not use needles or drugs. We do not commit fornication or adultery. We do not gamble. We do not lie, cheat, or steal. We are forbidden even to argue with one another, much less fight or draw each other's blood. It is against the very law of Islam and the law of nature for us to be lazy and sit around waiting and begging somebody else to do for us what we could do for ourselves. And one thing that I failed to mention a moment ago, that filthy swine. God has divinely prohibited through the time of Moses that man should eat the swine. If you just think for a moment of that ugly creature, that filthy creature, and what the swine eats, how in the world could an intelligent man go and eat that which eats his garbage, eats dung?
There is a generation of people who are seeking precisely that kind of discipline because the drugs are taking over. The mid-70s is a period of the beginning of the decline. The violence is taking over. The handguns are made available cheaply. Crime is going up. Farrakhan wasn't interested in a political agenda. It was against the rules of the Nation of Islam to adopt a political agenda. It's not until really 1980 that you begin to see the Nation of Islam under Farrakhan's leadership becoming more politically active.
It is not our hands that will bring about the fall of America. It is the divine power of Almighty God, Allah, that is now bringing about the destruction of the United States of America. Her destruction will serve as a warning to all of Europe that America, in her bold mistreatment of the very people of God, is now reaping what she has sown. The same divine plagues that God sent against Pharaoh in Egypt are now visible in America.
Manu Dibango on WVLS with Soul Makusa. A brand new baby, but he's already a heroin addict. He was on heroin for 9 months before he was born because his mother is a junkie. He has all the symptoms. He has fits. He won't eat. And he never stops crying. He'll have to go through withdrawal. Cold turkey. Then, nobody knows for sure. But he may not grow up as fast as other boys. He could suffer permanent brain damage. And chances are good he'll end up in a foster home. With no mother, no father, nothing but his own life. Some life.
There's no hope in dope. Alba, you always remember that, especially with the school children out of school for the summer, and it's summer in the city.
I used to steal from my mother. I used to do things I really didn't want to do. I had family problems. My stepfather asked me out. That's something I'm holding, and I could never come up and tell my mother, you know, that her husband asked me to go out. You know, that's something I had to hold in. The easiest thing I knew how to do was to prostitute, right? I used to go up in Prospect Avenue and hang out on the corners up there till somebody come along and whistle or drive their car by, right? They used to call me off. I used to get in there. I used to say, you want a blowjob, you know, something. They take me to the hotel. And I get down with them. I didn't want to do it, but it's something that I had to do. I got down with them for about $5, $6. Then I find that wasn't enough. Had to do it constantly. About 10 men just to get $30. And I couldn't care who it was, you know. It didn't make me no difference who it was, where he came from, as long as he had a couple of dollars to give me. My little sisters, they wouldn't respect me, you know. They would be embarrassed to walk down the street with me and shit. I had no self-confidence in myself. Until my brother had came into a program, right? And I was still, I wasn't ready to come in. Because I was, you know, I thought dope was in, you know. Kept shooting dope. I liked it. Because it feels like when I was high off heroin, I could talk to people, you know. I could party along with people. I don't have to stay in the house, watch TV, go to bed, get up. I hanged out all night, wouldn't go to sleep. At the time, I liked what I was doing. I didn't know why, until I got hooked on it. Then I had to get it. I was doing things I didn't want to do. Now I'm just trying to make it now. I think I can make it.
I think the Black Power movement, see, I always think of it as three different movements, three different legacies. The most evident
is this idea of building black institutions, buying black, supporting black business, but not necessarily transforming or revolutionizing society. Nowadays, it's manifest in slogans like the color of black power is green. It's about making money and supporting our businesses. It's not a revolutionary ideology. Another extreme, and that is a kind of cultural nationalism. And it goes in ebbs and flows. When Spike Lee's film Malcolm X came out, it was the height of a kind of cultural nationalist sort of resurrection. And then finally, the other element is the black radical tradition. It's a tradition of struggle, of organization. And how does it exist today? It certainly exists in certain forms of hip hop. You know, you can actually chart both the organizational forms and rhetoric of black power in second wave feminism, in the gay liberation movement, where the gay liberation movement post Stonewall in New York, but also in San Francisco, in many ways adopted the language of black power, gay power, feminist power.
Sometimes I feel like there's a lot of rebuilding in order, and a lot of that is going to come from just the old-fashioned principle of reading books. And more importantly, we have to write and document our history right now. It's really not about black and white. It's about the story. If we're going to tell the story, let's tell the story right. So that's why we as black people have to tell our own stories. We have to document our history. When we allow someone else to document our history, the history becomes twisted and we get written out. We get our noses blown off.
Because of the historical aspects of people of African descent here in the United States of America, it's been a tremendous ride here since slavery and since Ku Klux Klan and all this madness in this country, you see. And so the black man in America has been able to survive all of this and be able to express himself through music and through art and through all kinds of things, and been able to utilize the government here and the rules and regulations, the Constitution and Declaration of Independence, and utilize this in a nonviolent way to be a part of one of the greatest countries that's ever been, United States of America.
It's not a day that I don't get up and thank a Stokely and a Malcolm and a Kathleen and an Angela who did this very hard work for us to begin to not only see the country, but to see ourselves and to love ourselves. When you love yourself, you don't want to hurt someone else. And the other thing is that when you love yourself, you greet people as an equal.
I think the story of my trial is an important story. You know, we can talk about others, Bobby Seale and Erica Huggins and Huey Newton and go on and on. And the real import of the positive outcomes of these trials is that they demonstrated that people can collectively generate the kind of power that can be earth-shaking, that can change lives, that can change societies. And people need to know that, particularly in the 21st century, it is important, even under a black president, to bring the kind of pressure, to force the kinds of issues that will allow us to imagine a future without war and without racism and without prisons.
If you look at the world, my dear brother, you could wake up, you could say, I don't want to get up out of bed. Because, I mean, the rich are getting richer, not only in America, but in the world. The young people have got to see it. I mean, sometimes a lot of the young people who are in their 40s now say, I'm tired. I say, you can't be tired. Take a rest, take a vacation. But this is a lifetime job. We've got to talk about that 1% or 5% that runs everything, you know? It's a lot of work. You don't get any reward. So you really don't get a reward. You know. But the point is that the reward is knowing that when you make transition, when you die, if you have children, there's a better world for them. And if you don't have children, there's a better world for other people too.